of yoga stop with yoga of enlightenment of consciousness. Vadala goes further. He says, there is, the second step should be yoga of immortality. Now it is not there. And the third step is called yoga of divinity. So yoga of enlightenment is given in mukti, that is by all the systems of spirituality. And yoga of immortality was given by the siddhas and the alchemists of the world. But the yoga of divinity was given only by the Vedas. Aham Brahmasmi, I am Atma Brahman, Tattvamasi, Prajnanam, Brahma. Four Mahavakyas. They mean only one thing, that is, man is potential God. But how to translate it into reality? That was the question. And that was not properly answered by either Patanjali or by other rishis. I'm not putting the blame on the great souls. What I mean to say is that being a scientist in temperament, behavior, and his activity in life, he translated this Mahavakya, Aham Brahmasmi, into truth. And he has given us the nature of divinity itself, and the yoga and science of how to make it into a reality. So that is the yoga of divinity. It has got three sections. First, this impure body has to be transformed into a pure body. It is called Sutta Deham. And then this pure body will start producing nectar. And what is the aim of Alala's yoga? See, this body should become self-sufficient. What I mean by that is that we are dependent upon nature for three things. Unless these three things are given to us, we will die. One is food, another is breath or prana, the third is knowledge. Without these three things coming from the external nature, all of us will die, even the gods are no exemption. And Vallala's aim of yoga is to make this human body into a divine body. What is a divine body? It is self-sufficient, like the sun. All the other planets are dark in nature, but the sun is self-sufficient, self-radiating. It is producing light. In the same way, this body is capable of producing its own food, its own prana, vega kal, its own knowledge, arulayu or valayu. So that is the final end of the yoga of Vallala. And it is given in three stages. First, mukti. Muktiyai petren, amuktiyinal, jnana siddhiyai uttren endru undi para, siddhanum aaniyan endru undi para. So first you should become a mukta, and then you should become a siddha, and then finally you should attain the state of Brahman or divinity. So this is the end of the course of history, human history, natural history, all the history. God descended into this creation. It was called involution. Now we are going backwards towards the same, but we are climbing the same ladder. So it's ranks, it is called evolution. What is the end of evolution? Man should become divine. To lead a divine life in a divine body is the end of my yoga of integrality, says Sri Aurobindo. That was said by Swami Vallala some 100 years before Sri Aurobindo and the mother. Unfortunately, their yogas did not produce any bodily transformation in them because they were only experimenting. But Swami Vallala succeeded in his experiments because he had before him the Siddha tradition starting from Valluvar, who says even death can be conquered. Kutram kudithalum kaigur. So that is history. Today we are going to concentrate only upon the practicals. Now, yoga of enlightenment. Yesterday I told you what is Turiya. Now we are in the wakeful state. At night we are going to enter into a state of sleep. And during sleep we are going to enter into a state of dream. So this consciousness is like a frog. The Maharishi, exact Maharishi perhaps was more right than Darwin. Darwin says we descended from apes, but Maharishi says, Maharishi of Mandukya Upanishad says, we are all frogs. Like frogs, we are jumping from one state of consciousness into another. We are three persons. One person during wakeful state comes up, wakes up and acts. During sleep, another person wakes up and he is asleep, that's all. And we don't know what he is doing. There is yet another person acting through the dream state. So we are three persons, we are three fragments. First, all these three fragments of our consciousness should be united into one person, that is me. So if you are watchful, if you are aware of what is going on in your dream state, you can master the dream state. And then I wanted you to keep a dream notebook for that. And there are exercises for that. Yoga of sleep is there. You can a whole lecture on that part. Again, yoga of wakefulness. During the wakeful state, if you are watching not only what is happening in the external world, but also inside your mind and body, how is your body reacting to something? How is your body reacting to something? See, some of you are sitting in the dark, some of you are sitting in the light. But what? Because their body needs more sunlight to counteract this cold. So you must be constantly watching the reactions of your body and your mind. So it should be a two-way traffic. A new habit we have to form, and that habit should be there permanently established in the body. And finally, you should be aware of your sleep. I gave you an indication the other day that you should be able to hear your own snoring. Then you are aware of your sleep. So when this fourth state of consciousness called the witnessing consciousness, as Lord Krishna says in the Gita, this witnessing consciousness is established all through the time, all the 24 hours, all through the year, all the 365 days. Now, even at the time of death, if you are aware of what is happening at the time of death, you will become a Jivan Mukta, you will not die. Because your soul is in the form of knowledge. As long as that knowledge is retained in you, Lord of death cannot take away your soul. That was what happened to all the Jivan Muktas. They were able to retain their consciousness from the hands of the death, because they were always aware. They never lost their consciousness even for a single moment. Yesterday I told you about the Taila Tara. That is like an oil pouring down which has no cessation of consciousness. You should have no cessation of consciousness. You must always retain your consciousness. That is the only purpose. That is the only way of attaining enlightenment. How to attain enlightenment? Never lose your consciousness, even for a second. That is why Swami Vallalar says, no sleep, no samadhi, no death. Because all these three things are cessation of consciousness. Once you have cessation of consciousness, you have become a slave to nature. You are a slave to your instincts, but you should be a master of all of your instincts. And sleep is an instinct. What are all the instincts? They are our masters. See, we are controlled by these two 22 strings of instinct, by the master nature, Panchabhutas. We have to be, on the contrary, masters of the Panchabhutas. We have to transform, according to the yoga of Vallalar, these five Panchabhutas into light of compassion. Well, that comes according to the yoga of divinity. Let us talk about it later. Now, one must attain the state of Turiya. If you are always in a state of Turiya, you are enlightened. Your consciousness will be retained, though your body goes and it is burnt or being buried. So, attainment of Turiya. And there are, Vallalar says, there are four levels of Turiya that comes under the yoga of divinity. What are the four levels of Turiya? Jiva Turiya, Paraturiya, Siva Turiya, Sutta Siva Turiya. The explanations we can have later. Now, the second thing is yoga of immortality. And they give you a formula. As Einstein summed up his relativity theory in the form of AE is equal to MC squared. The Siddhas give us a formula. And if you can successfully practice that formula in your life, Well, you can attain immortality of the body, that is consciousness of the enlightenment of the body also. It is called the Kaya Siddhi, immortality. It is possible according to the Vedas. We know about, we are taught about the seven Chiranjeevis in our epics like Anjaneya, Markandeya. We got about Aswatthama and seven Chiranjeevis are talked about. Though the exact science is not given there, Vallalar Swami has given us the complete science of one becoming immortal. So, Sagatalaive Pogapunal Vega Vega Pogapunal Vega Kal. It is not Vega Talai, it is Vega Kal. Sorry. No, Sagatalai means undying head. What is undying? Now breath is going inside our head. And it is dying, it should not die. Talai saha talai, Swami explains. And this breath that is going through our nostrils is called now sagum talai. It is dying breath. Whether it goes through the left nostril or through the right nostril, you are going to die. And this should be transformed into pari. It is called, that it is given in the fable of Nariyai Pariyakkudal, Pariyai Nariyakkudal in the Tiruvasaram. Now this breath is known as forms. What is it known for? For its cleverness. For its cleverness. So as long as this breath goes, you will be, your intelligence will be very cunning, very clever, but it is not compassionate. You cannot go too far. Pari means horse. A horse can run faster. And in the days of the Vedas and the Siddhas, what was the, which had the highest speed? This horse. Now it is the rocket. So pari means you can with that breath reach any place in cosmos in a moment. So this breath must be replaced by another higher form of breath called undying breath, Vega Kal, unburning, inexhaustible breath. When you have that sort of breath, you will not need this oxygen. This oxygen is dead by installment. It creates oxidation. Out of oxidation, you get oxidants. For that, you are prescribed by the doctor antioxidants. So it is killing us slowly. It is damaging our cell walls. It is damaging our body. Instead of oxygen, if you learn to breathe that eternal breath, it is called the holy breath, and it is also called Paramahamsam. What is Paramahamsam? I already told you, Hamsam is a fabled bird that is able to separate the milk from the water. Now we are inhaling a mixture of oxygen plus prana. If you are able to inhale directly prana without the oxygen, you are a Paramahamsa. How to do it? That is the purpose and aim of Vasi Yoga. Then you can become a Paramahamsa. You can directly live on Prana Shakti, that is God's power of creation. You need not bother about this external air or breathing or oxygen. You become a Siddha. Our astronauts carry, what do they carry with them? Oxygen cylinders. The Siddhas don't carry any oxygen cylinders, but they are able to travel throughout the cosmos with this prana shakti. If you are able to directly take your prana shakti, you can travel anywhere. Your very body will become like a rocket. That is how these siddhas roam around the universe. That's all possible when you have mastered this technique of Paramahamsam. That is the end of Vasi Yoga. That's why Swami says God himself is described as Vegada Kalanai, and Swami had attained it. Now, Poga Punal, what is meant by Poga Punal? A liquid, by its very nature, it flows from the highest place to the lowest place because of gravitation. But this Poga Punal, it will resist the power of gravitation. It is anti-gravitational matter. Once you take it into your body, it will stay in your body and it will always be giving you, it will quench your water. This is talked about in the Gospel. Jesus Christ goes to a Samaritan woman who is taking water from the well, and he tells her, Oh woman, if you can give me this well water, I will give you water of life. Water of life? What do you mean, sir? It will stay in your body and it will, like a spring, will eternally give you water and you won't have any thirst at all. And what is that? Water of life. It is not described. And Swami gives us the details. That's why I say, if you can read Vadala Sirvarupa, well, you will be provided with the key to open all the scriptures of the world. That is the Poga Punal. Poga Punal means it is not removed from your body. It stays always in your body. That kind of Amrita nectar is produced from the external nature by the Siddhas, but Vadalar says it can be produced in one's own body. And finally, Sagatale Poha Punal Vehaka. This is the yoga of immortality. And finally, yoga of divinity. And there are three stages. Now our body is in an impure condition. It is creating only waste material. And that waste material is sent out of the body, excreted through the 9 orifices of the body. So we have unfortunately transformed our body into a factory where only waste material is created, excretory matter is created, but by God's design, this body was created to be to create only Amrita nectar. How to transform this impure condition into a pure body where only nectar will be produced? When nectar is produced, what happens? You don't need a heart to pump your blood all through the body. You don't need oxygen from the external atmosphere to charge your cells. Both these things will be taken care of by the nectar produced in the body. Madalelam moolai malarndida amudam udalelam uttredu thodi nirambida, he will say. There all the 8 systems of the body will be transformed into the higher stages. That is the pure body. Once you attain the pure body, it is supposed to be alive. Its lifespan is about 432,000 years. That is the impure body, then you become a Siddha. And this impure body is transformed into a space body or Omkara body. That is how you become Shambhu Murti. That is, you have been blessed by your parents with that name. Who is Shanmuga Murti? If you can understand the meaning of that word, well, some of the greatest secrets of the Vedic rishis are revealed by that name. When Adi Shankara wanted to write a commentary on the Brahma Sutras, he went to get his blessings from his guru. And his guru said, do you want to write commentaries on the Brahma Sutras? You can do one thing. Go and read this Kanda Purana. There the secret is revealed. Suya Brahmam. See, what is the name of Subramanya Muruga? Su Brahmam. Su means Swayam. Self-made Brahman. How is a man to transform himself into Brahman? That secret is revealed in the story of the birth of Lord Muruga. So you read that person, Suta Samhita it is called. And it is, according to legend, Adi Shankara read it 18 times. How many times? 18 times to know that secret. After that only he wrote his commentaries on the Brahma Sutras, because Brahma Sutras reveal the very nature of Brahman himself, God himself. After that he wrote his commentaries, and that secret was kept there hidden for some 1300 years. After that Vadalar came and he revealed that secret in the form of his flag. It is called flag of Sanmarga. There is a lecture there, it is called a flag meditation. We won't have flag meditation taught today, perhaps in the next session. We have got 4 levels of yoga taught by Vadala. Today we are going to see the first levels. Some 10 meditations are there. We will see what time allows us. See, the next thing is, from space body, from this Omkara body will be like a rocket. It can travel at the speed of light or perhaps more. Not at the speed of light, it can travel faster, because according to Vadalar Swami, there are 3 types of light. One is physical light that goes at the speed of 300 kilometers per second. And there is satellite called Love. It is faster by millions of times. And there is the final light of compassion, which is the fastest light. It, in a second, it can travel to any galaxy. So, and Shanmugamurthy, how is it formed? Let me hint at it. I don't have the full time to explain it. That itself will take an hour. See, now you are taught beautifully by Dr. Shanmugamurthy how to transform your sexual fluid into your health and longevity. That is true. And Swami Vallalar says this Bindu, spiritual energy is called Bindu. It has got two meanings. One is the liquid form of semen and sronita. This should be transformed into light by pure heat. That is what we are doing by the yoga of Kayakalpa, prayer, meditation, penance, tapas, like that. By that pure heat, this liquid is transformed into, first into an air. And then it is transformed finally into light. And that light is stored at the center of your forehead. And finally, what happens, you know, it coagulates itself into a solid body of crystal that has got six facets. A crystal of six facets. That is Shanmugam. Shanmugam means six faces. Then what happens? Your body is transformed from a pure body into an Omkara body, and you become literally like Lord Subramanya. Like Subramanya, who was to defend the gods against all the forces of darkness. You become the captain of light. You become the master of light. So this is the Omkara body. And finally, this light body of compassion is all pervasive. God's body is everywhere. It is hundreds and hundreds of times much bigger than this cosmos. Behind these physical atoms, you have got this light of compassion, all pervasive. It is the power that activates the inner subatomic particles like electron, proton and other things. So your body becomes everywhere. It becomes all pervasive. So this is the ultimate yoga, and there is no further yoga beyond the yoga of Vallalar. That is why I say, where other yogas end, Vallalar's yoga begins. Now, we are going to see some of the meditations of the first form of yoga of enlightenment. Now, first, next three things we are going to cover. Every act of every day should be transformed into an act of yoga. That is what Vallalar says. What does yoga mean? Yoga means perfection, efficiency in your action. Any act, if you do cooking, it should be perfect. It should give you perfect taste. If you sit properly, you must sit. It should give you energy. You should not lose it. You see the photograph of Swami Vallalar. Vikram? See how Vallalar Swami sits. See, this is the correct posture of sitting. This is the yoga of sitting. See, he's sitting in Padmasana, Atta Padmasana or Padmasana. That is the way you have to sit. Then what happens? All of your energy is circulating inside the body. You don't lose it. And then he's clasping his left hand, left palm with the right palm. When you sit like this, this is the perfect posture. This is the yoga of sitting. By sitting like this, you will never lose your energy. Your back should be straight, and your legs and your hands, they should be united. By this, you are uniting both the parts of the body. Left body is the feminine body. The right side of the body is called male body, Ardhanarishvara. Every one of us, either male or female, is Ardhanarishvara. By uniting these two forces, one becomes more powerful than gods and goddesses. That is why all the Siddhas say this left side, our left feet, left hands, left eye, all these things are called you, Ugaram. And the right eye, right hand, right foot, all these things are called Agaram. 8. So when these 8 plus 2 are combined together, what happens? You give you beget a child. When A plus U, they are united, what happens? M is formed. That is how ohm is given. How do we get ohm? The right side is A, the left side is U. When they are, when these two are united at the center of the forehead, what do you get? Ohm. Dr. Shanmugamurthy was correctly pronouncing it. First, we start with when you close your lips, what happens? M is automatically formed inside. M means silence. So you get Om. And Omkara, translation, I mean Omkara Yoga has got five states. What is that? First you start with the agaram, right hand, breathing through the right nostril, and then ugaram, breathing through the left nostril. When these two are united at the throat, it is called the Vasa Yoga. Then what happens? Immediately you get silence, M. Oh, if you still persist, what happens? The fourth state is called Bindu. Bindu means you will have light, real light, subtle light, divine light. If you still persist, you will have Paranada. You will hear the sound of the anklet of Lord Shiva. That is Om. That is A plus U plus M plus Bindu plus Nada. So Omkara has got five parts, five syllables. This is how we practice Omkara. Well, let us go to the next session. You see, daily regimen, Nitya Ulukam, four discipline. Swami has given us discipline of the senses, discipline of mind, discipline of psyche, discipline of spirit. Now, discipline of the senses. Now we saw the meditation of sitting. Now the meditation of walking. How do we walk? Normally we walk in parallel lines. See, we walk like this. Like the railway road, we walk on the parallel lines. Now, instead of walking on parallel lines, according to this yoga, when you walk on a straight line, see, this is a straight line. You walk on a straight line. You could have seen these people doing in Hindu temples. When you walk on the straight line, what happens? Both the breaths, Idakala and Pingala, they are united, and your breath through the central column called Sushumna, it will be awakened. The purpose of all activities is to awaken your Kundalini yoga and send it upwards through the spinal column. So the walking, very act of walking, can be transformed into an act of yoga. That is what Swami does. Every act of your life is done mistakenly, and we have to correct it. And Swami has given us exactly what to do. For instance, the meditation of eating. How to do it? We don't know how to eat at all. We don't know what is the right food for us to eat. We eat meat and other sorts of poison, and we are poisoning our body every moment. And Swami says, you have to eat only the choicest food. How is atomic energy got? By using only a particular type of 235, what is it called? Uranium. Uranium. So that is already emitting energy. In the same way, certain foods have got highest form of emitting energy. So you will immediately get that energy. Calcium in the metals, calcined minerals, and undecaying foods. Well, that's a separate subject. So choice of food is given to you. The second thing is, Swami says, you should drink your food. Ni arunduga, unavai arunduga. What does he mean by that? You have to grind it at least 100. You take a mouthful and grind it 108 times. There is a proverb in Siddha literature. It says, instead of taking 108 mouthfuls and munching it once, you take one mouthful and munch it, chew it, grind it, masculate it 108 times, you will get more in it. So we have, in the name of fast food and eating fast, we are not getting enough energy out of the food. You are dumping our body with 2 kilograms, 3 kilograms of food, but To what result? We are not extracting enough energy out of that. How to get extract energy out of that? By munching it and mixing it with your saliva and then making it into a juice and drinking it. Not with the juicer or mixture. God has provided with the best mixture grinder in our mouth. With our saliva, you have to mix it and then take it. You are given 1 hour for lunch time. How much of lunch time you are making use of for your lunch? 2 minutes? Or 1 minute? Fast food. Swallow everything. Please never, never, never swallow. You are hurting your body like anything. If your cells in the digestive system, if they have got tongues, you know, they will cry like anything. You are making them work 100 times difficult, more difficult. So please chew and masticate your food. Take your own time. Make use of the lunch time. Only for lunch. Don't talk. Don't converse. Nothing. Nothing whatsoever you should do. And Scripture says, "Potri unga." Worship. In the days of the Vedas, people used to call Annam Brahmam. What is that? Annam Brahmam. Why did they say that? This Annam goes to create your semen, and that semen and Sronida, they go to make a man, and that man, by practicing meditation, becomes attains Brahman. So Annam becomes Brahman. What is Brahmacharya? The word Sanskrit word Brahmacharya means, Ascharyam means to preserve. Brahmam. When you are preserving your semen, which is potential Brahman, you are preserving Brahman. You are creating Brahman. You are Brahma. Ascharyam means you have to preserve, safeguard, save. When you save your semen, you are saving whom? Brahman in potential. That semen is transformed into a human being. That human being could be transformed into a rishi who could attain Turiya, who could attain Paraturiya, Sivaturiya, and even attain Brahman state. So, Brahmacharya is the ultimate yoga. And Vallalar Swami says, you must have sex only once in 16 days. This is meant for the householders, not for others. For sadhaks, he said, not even a single drop of semen or sronida should be wasted. That is the most precious thing in the world. If you are a sadhak, that is your purpose. And for your information, I'll tell you, there is a small medicine called selenium, potency 6 or 30. Along with your kayakalpa practice, if you can take 3 globules before you go to sleep, well, your sexual juices will be preserved. It is called selenium 6 or 30. 6 will work with some people, 30 will work with some other people. Make it a point. Those who want to practice Brahmacharya can keep this in their mind, in their minds. And the next thing is, when you eat, how much of food you should eat? What is the quantity? Teen alavar indu unga. Teen alavar indu unga says Vaalluvar. What does he mean by that? Well, what is your hunger? It is some sort of a fire in your stomach. When you eat, what happens? That fire is quenched. When it is quenched, stop it. Don't overeat it. Not even a single extra mouthful should be added to your food. So who determines how much food you should take? Not you. The fire in your stomach, listen to it. Listen to the wisdom of the body. Then you will not fall sick. You will be always healthy. That Jadaragni is called. According to the Vedas, this body produces 7 types of heat. I don't have time to enter into that. Well, this Jadaragni, you know, in your stomach, it should be kept up constantly. There should not be any lack of this Jadaragni. This fire should be kept up. And it should be fed only as much as it wants, not you want. You have already taken your breakfast and you meet a friend, he says, let's go and have a cup of coffee. No. You say, I had my breakfast. Well, only when my stomach says, feed me, I should drink. Not because of your friendship. I'm not going to spoil my body. I'm not going to make it fall sick. So that is the quantity of food. And then Swami says, food has got five laws of nutrition. First thing, it should give you maximum heat with minimum quantity. The second thing is, it should not give you constipation. The third thing is, it should be easily digestible. And the fourth thing is, it gives you every object in the world, every being in the world is a mixture of poison and nectar. And Swami has given us a list of foods that contain the highest nectar quotient. See, it's a different object. Our nutrition scientists do not know. He says certain foods have got highest quotient of nectar. So see how much of nectar is in a thing and how much of poison is there. Your duty is to remove the poison first of all from the food and then take only the nectar portion. Then the next portion is, the next level is to do this thing by your cooking in the external world. Don't give this job to your difficult job of separating the poison from the nectar to your digestive system. Do it outside. What is the purpose of cooking? Separating the poison from the nectar. That is the purpose of cooking. Even the wisest Socrates was wrong. He said the purpose of cooking is to make the food tasty. No, to make the food endurable. Your milk will last for 1 or 2 days. Even if you keep it in the refrigerator, it may last for a few weeks. But if you convert it into, curd and then turn it into butter and then you do it into clarified butter, ghee, what happens? It lasts for 1 or 2 years. So the durability and the lifespan of the food should be extended. That is the purpose of cooking. So when you cook, you remove the poison from the foodstuff and you eat only the nectar portion of it. Unfortunately, our nutrition scientists, they calculate only about the calorie, but how much of gastric juices are used for translating this food into calories? We lose more. Actually, we are not getting enough. So that exchange is not taken care of. That should be taken care of. So Swami has given everything in this. Before that, potri unga, how to eat, with what type of mentality. Our mind is elsewhere and we are dumping food into our stomach. That is not the way to eat. And Swami says, have two things. First, you take the food with your hand. He was brilliantly telling you about that, the importance of food. We live by food. And you consider that food as divine. And how what do you say to yourself? Yan irupozhudhu unda unavu muzhuvadhum amudamayina. Vallar Swami says, when you eat that food, with what intention you are eating? Oh God, please transform this food entirely into energy. Mind the words. How much of energy is transformed? How much of food is transformed into energy? Very little. And Swami says, Yan irupozhudhu unda unavu muzhuvadhum. The food was totally transformed into energy. That was how he was able to live with enormous energy, with very little food. But how much of energy we get out of our food? We eat a lot. We eat very, very much. But how much of energy we get? Very little. So with this intention, you have to eat. Pray to God. Pray to God inside you. Please transform this food into complete energy. All the food should be totally transformed into energy. If you persist in this affirmation, your digestive system, you are talking to your digestive system and your absorption system, and your food will be totally transformed into energy. Then you will not need so much of energy. There will not be any hunger problem or famine in the world. So talk to your digestive system. They are sensible. They are already functioning divinely, even without your own permission. If you are allowed to manage your digestive system, what will happen? You will not last even for a week. It is being taken care of by the God. So please talk to that God. Thank God. Consider food as divine. Don't waste it. Every day we are wasting a lot of food. Okay, that is meditation of eating and very important thing, excretion. Swami does not leave anything for chance. This is called a toilet meditation. Some of you might laugh. Even this thing, could this thing be translated into an act of yoga? Yes, Swami says, go to the toilet first thing in the morning. First thing in the morning, you must have that urge. Actually, that urge to excrete should get you out of your body. That is the indication that your body is properly functioning. How to do that? If you find that your urinating is not complete, that something is there in your bladder, and Swami gives us a technique. He says, by your left hand, you hold the right side of your stomach. Please do that. Otherwise, the habit will not be formed. Otherwise, once the habit is initiated, it will continue. Now, with your left hand, you touch the right side of your stomach and concentrate on urinating. And until the whole bladder is emptied of urine, you should not think of any other things. If you do not practice concentration in your job, in your office, it's all right. Well, but this is very dangerous. Your bladder should be completely emptied. In the same way, the second thing, passing stools. When you go to the toilet, make sure that all of your bowels are completely cured. This is very, very important. It is not a laughable matter, because constipation is the worst disease possible. It is the mother of all diseases. If there is constipation, if it persists, what will happen? It will give piles and fistula. If you still ignore it, what happens? It may turn into colon cancer. The doctors here will tell you more about it. So it's the worst thing of all. So there should be no constipation at all. Swami says there should not be constipation in two places, in the lower Mooladhara and in the upper Mooladhara with the phlegm. That's why he wants you to take this Parisalite. We are going to see that. Eclipta alba, first thing in the morning with your milk or with hot water. And then you have to rub the paste of the Eclipta alba upon the roof of your mouth. Then what will happen? Even the excessive phlegm will come out. You won't have any sinus problem, asthma problem, and other respiratory problems. So this is about food. And after that, every act should be done as an act of yoga. Well, I will now pass on to the, there are about 80 acts of yoga. 80 acts of everyday acts of yoga are transformed into actions of yoga by Swami. It is given in Nitya Udukam. It is called the daily regimen. Daily regimen, the CD is there. I don't have time to enter into all that. This whole lecture has been given on that. 80 things which we are doing in our everyday act, they have been perfected. You have to do according to that. Then you will not fall sick. You will not have diseases. The body will not be impaired. Now we are entering into the... Swami says, well, how to discipline your mind. எப்போதும் சிச்சவையின் கண்ணே கவனம் வைக்க, அதற்கு முதலில் புருவ மத்தியில் கவனம் வைக்க. There are two steps for controlling your mind. How to do that? The first thing is புருவ மத்தி. Third eye meditation. Well, yeah, it's all right. Walking meditation is over. I told you, no, to walk on the straight line. Now, about discipline of the mind. Now, please sit erect. I think we have already done it in some other place, but I find new faces. For the enlightenment, we have to do it. Just for 1 minute. Now remove your glasses, please. With your right thumbnail, scratch in between your eyebrows for an inch from the bottom up, just for an inch. And close your eyes and watch that pain. This is the place where you should always concentrate. If you concentrate on this point, 6 types of energies which you are losing at every moment, you will be saving, you will be conserving it. Your reproductive, please close your eyes and concentrate on that place. This is the most important place in the entire cosmos. This is where your body and mind are united. This is where your body and soul are united. This is where your soul and God, our soul is united. This is where your body is connected with nature. This is where your mind and buddhi and soul are connected. So this is the place of utmost importance. That is why Swami says, all the 24 hours, your attention should never, never come down from this place. This will make you a siranjeevi. Siratileye jeevipavan, one who always lives in the head, like Anjaneya. He is supposed to be an immortal. If you want to become an immortal, or at least, if you don't want your health to be impaired, please concentrate on this place. Please close your eyes and put your concentration on that place. Just to concentrate on that place for 5 minutes, you will feel refreshed. You will have a lot of energy. Because all the six energies, every moment you are losing will be saved. What are the six energies? Your reproductive juices, your gastric juices, your breath, and then your speech, and then your eyesight, and then your thought. All these six forms of energy you are constantly losing to gravitation. If you concentrate on this place, you will be preserving, conserving, and saving all these six types of energy. If you can do it for a few years, you can have more energy than the Kundalini energy, according to Jiddu Krishnamurti, the Indian born philosopher. Very simple technique, but very helpful. It will give you all the health, it will give you all the brain power, it will save your sexual energy, it will give you brahmacharya. Thank you. Now, we are entering into the second phase. What is the second phase? Now, Swami says, there is a place where God dwells inside your body. That place is called Sitchavai. Eppodum Sitchavai in Kanni Gavanam Vaikka. Unfortunately, that place has been hinted at in all the scriptures of the world, but nobody has revealed so far exactly where is this place. In our anatomy, even Christ says, the kingdom of God is within you. Our Thirumular says, நெற்றிக்கு நேரே புருவத்து இடைவெளியில் உற்று உற்று பார்க்க ஒளியுடும் மந்திரம் பற்றுத்து பற்றாய் பரமன் இருந்த இடம் சிற்றம்பலம் என்று தேர்ந்து கொண்டேனே. Exactly where is it? At the center. You see, that is the cross. What is the cross? What does it mean by it? You have the perpendicular line from the center. This is the center place of the crown. Crown opening it is called. Melvasal, in Tamil it is called. There is a small place here, you know, if you touch the newborn baby, you can find some small pit there. It is called crown pit. From that crown pit, you have a perpendicular line through your ovula and then through the eyes. You have a straight line, horizontal line. When these two lines meet in one place, and that center is called cross. At that point, you have your soul Atman. You can find it out. Swami Vallala tells us, he has given us a mantra. We don't have much time to explain all those things. I'll pronounce it. Please pronounce with me. Four steps are there. What is that? Pronounce along with me that mantra. Second thing is, hold your breath for a minute. Third thing is, you have to keep your tongue up in the air. It should not touch the upper palate, it should not touch the lower palate. And the last thing is, there will be some kind of pressure above the roof of your mouth, and you should watch exactly the location of that place, and you can drop your tongue, you can breathe out. So, where is that pressure coming from? That pressure point is exactly the place where the Atman is situated, that is Sitrambalam, that is Sidambaram. So, that is where God dwells, that is where your Atman is. Find out that place at the time of death. Whoever keeps his attention in that place will become a Jivan Mukta. As simple as that. And I hope all those who are assembled in this hall must have Mukti in this birth itself. You pray to your Guru, you pray to God for giving you the boon of the success of this yoga. Now I am going to pronounce that. Please stay with me. Sit straight. Up.
Up.
Hold your tongue, hold your breath. Watch where that sound came from, the origin of the sound, and there will be some sort of pressure upon the, above the roof of your mouth. You can feel it. Just locate that point. Locating is important. That is where your Atman, Uyir, is. This is the ultimate secret of secrets, kept hidden by the Siddhas all over the ages. Shall I repeat it once again? Up.
Up.
There will be some pressure above the roof of your mouth. Do you find it? Those who have found it, please raise their hands. Very good, very good. Oh, there are only 5 minutes left. Shall we pass on to other exercises? Or somebody has got some doubts as to the location of the place? Please, those who want to continue it, raise your hands. Okay, I'll tell it once more. Please watch 4 steps. First, pronounce with me. Second, hold your breath, hold your tongue, and see where the pressure is. 4 steps. Okay, now up.
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 Hold your tongue, hold your breath. Watch the pressure, where it comes from, above the roof of your mouth. There'll be a place. Do you find the pressure there? Very good. How many of you feel the pressure there? Oh. Oh, very good. Very good. Okay. Now rub your palms, put them in front of your eyes, looking at the palms, please come out of your meditation. That is how one should enter into meditation and come out of it slowly, not in a hurried manner. That will impair the system of the body. Now we are going to see the third eye meditation. This is very, very important. This will boost the energy of your brain. Unfortunately, now they say about 5%, not even 5%, 3% of our brain cells are functioning. Even with the great scientists like Einstein, from 5 to 50% of their brain cells are functioning. And the remaining 85%, they are lying dormant, they are lying asleep, they are totally useless. We have to activate the whole brain. Then what happens? According to the film, Hollywood film Lucy, everyone can become a Siddha. If 100% of the cells of the brain are activated, everyone should see that film, not for its entertainment, not for its crime and violence, but the theme is a brilliant theme. It's the theme of the future. It is called Lucy, L-U-C-I-E, Lucy. Now, the third eye meditations. Now we have seen 2 things. What is that? Focusing on the third eye period, third eye location. And the second thing is exactly where is this Chitrambalam. Now, the third meditation is that we have to breathe through the third eye. You have seen the picture of Shiva. You have seen the vertical eye of Shiva. Though you are breathing through your nostrils, you are creatively imagining, visualizing that you are breathing through the third eye. You are inhaling through the third eye and you are exhaling through the third eye. Then what happens? This place will be activated. This Ajna Chakra will be activated. Shall we do that? Okay, so you should start. Remove your glasses. Now make a scratch with your thumbnail. Now you start inhaling through the third eye. Forget about your nostril and its breath. It will naturally go on. But you are breathing through your third eye. Then what you are inhaling? Direct prana you are inhaling. Inhale deeply through the third eye. When you exhale, exhale through the third eye. Inhale through the third eye, exhale through the third eye. That is the organ of breathing. Do you feel that place activated? Do you feel some kind of a sensation as if an ant is crawling there? Yes, please come out of that. Now there is one more minute left. So we are going to enter into a very important meditation on the third eye. Now, please sit erect, close your eyes. Imagine that your brain is in the form of a white lotus bud. Imagine a white lotus bud in the region of your forehead. And in the midst, please imagine a flame. That is your Atman. Inside that flame is God Aruparanjyoti. So first imagine a white lotus bud, and at the center and above of that bud, imagine a flame. When this image is permanently established, please raise your hand. If you are able to see the white lotus bud, nothing but the lotus bud, please raise your hands. You have attained the first state of meditation. Imagine a white lotus bud. At the center and above it, there is a flame, a light, a lamp. That is your Atman. Now we are entering into the second state. We don't have time. Now imagine that bud is blossoming fully. That white lotus bud is blossoming fully with all the 1008 petals. Sahasrara. It is blossoming into a white lotus flower. All the 1008 petals are blossoming openly. They are opening. When a flower blossoms, what happens? You will have honey. It will produce honey. So, a honey of red color. It is called Sivaneer. It is given by the Lord. It is heavenly nectar. You have a spring at the center of the flower, and this red color honey is flowing like a spring, a fountain. From there, it fills up your entire head. Your Atman, that flame, is anointed with that. Abhishekam takes place with that honey, and it fills up your head, it fills up your throat, it fills up your shoulders, it fills up both the arms, and it comes down to the middle, and it fills up your chest, it fills up your stomach, that honey fills up your abdomen, it fills up your both of your legs. So the entire body is filled up with that nectar. Just imagine. Now it is an imagination, it is an act of imagination, but with the practice, with the right way of eating and thinking and praying and meditation, this will become an act of reality. When it happens, Jiva becomes Shiva. Jiva is being transformed into Shiva. This was what was called Soma Bana by the ancient rishis. Swamiji has given us the technique of achieving it. It is called Arulamudam, the ultimate form of the result of yoga. there are a few more meditational techniques at the level one, but unfortunately we don't have time. When I come next time, I'll try to instruct you with other forms of yoga. Please come out of your meditation. Arpirum jodi, arpirum jodi, anipirum karunai, arpirum jodi, illa uyidhalum inbutru vaalha, vallal malaradi vaalha vaalha. Thank God, thank Guru, peace. Take the blessings of the Guru. Without the blessings of the Guru and God, these yogas, ultimate yogas, well, they cannot be realized.